Well, let's see now. Fighting the 25, I guess you'd call them bumblebees, after the old bench there. Off. Travels with the Stevensons. Yeah, I'm going to do a little delivery run here today. Eric is stopping by on his way back to Louisville. Eric Guyman, that is, who graduated from the University of Bowling Green, Western Kentucky University. And it looks like I'm jumping a little bit. I'm experimenting with this camera holder so that I'm not holding it myself. And it's on a little springy gadget, so it might make you a little dizzy. But anyway, I'm running up to get La Rosa's for Eric and his roommate Jordan. They both found jobs graduating from Western Kentucky University. One's with one of the brewery places down in Louisville, and Eric's with a nonprofit corporation. In fact, they both might be nonprofits, I'm not sure. But we're going by the Independence Courthouse. That's where I got the idea to rig this thing up here so that I could sit there in front of the courthouse and sing a song or two, and then have the courthouse in the background. Make it sort of patriotic, you know. My little way of protesting the China's communist leaders hiding the dangers of this coronavirus from all the countries of the world, which is becoming more apparent every day. But dictatorships are not like what we have in our country called a republic. A constitution founded on godly principles. So, Miss June sent me on an errand after our church service today at Bethesda Community Church over on 989, I think it is, Mount Zion Road or Biscayne Boulevard, Memorial Parkway. Of course, passing the cemetery in Independence here now, Island Cemetery, Independence Cemetery, where June likes to come and do her walks. Both those cemeteries, where our bench is over in Island Cemetery in Fort Mitchell, and our Jesus statue is here, and that I like to sit in front of and sing and have as a background. Passing Miss Smallwood's house here shortly, 95 years old, read her Bible every year, probably about 55 years now. There she is, and Eddie Smallwood's, David Smallwood's mother. Well, we're coming into Independence now, and let's see here. Gonna go past Snappy Tomato and Wendy's and the good folks there. And all the banks lined up here. Fifth Third. U.S. Bank's back down the old Byron Stevens building that he was president of. And where's McDonald's, Kroger's, Walgreens. And, of course, Frisch's, where I manage Frisch's restaurants, not here, over in Evendale and Grosbeck, and was in their training program, training managers, and produced their first film on how to train managers and how to increase productivity. Back in the 60s, when Dave Frisch was still alive, and Bill Mappin, Marvin Fields, and Jack Baer, I believe it was, the son-in-law of Dave Frisch, and his wife, Antoinette. Frisch's was a good company, still is a good company. They've sold out, but they've got some good products here and a lot of good people. I'm always proud to say I'm a friend of the big boy. I'm sort of the big boy myself, in a way. But anyway, getting ready to go by Simon Kitten up here if we went up a little further, but where I graduated from high school in 1961. It was great teachers, great superintendents, principals, and just wonderful students. But I'm heading in here now to Buddy LaRose's Pizza. Got an order for us. I'm going to get some of them beautiful chicken wings they got and some chicken noodle soup. Oh my goodness gracious, yep. And some flatbread with cheese and some garlic bread with cheese. And something for Miss June. She's not feeling too hot, so I'm going to get her the chicken noodle soup. Got the American flag out here now, and they got a beautiful horse statue there they got put up. So I'm going to pull right in here and go inside and do my order. I'll shut the camera down for a few minutes here. Let's see here now. We're here, folks. And right next door to them now, Dunkin' Donuts. And boy, that's a good place to chow down to a little bit. But with my waistline being what you call rather enormous, and the fact the shut-ins here, I asked June before I left the house, I said, "You reckon I can get through the outside door?" She said, "John, if I keep feeding you that beautiful breakfast I've been feeding you, there might be questionable." But we'll go to LaRose's today. Check you in a few minutes. Well, I came into LaRose's here, one of my favorite stops here in Independence, Kentucky. And some wonderful people here have been waiting on me. And praise the Lord and pass the ammunition of godly principles. I just look at them and I say, "You are so beautiful to me. You are so beautiful to me that you see. You're everything I hope for. You're everything I need. LaRose's is so beautiful to me." You had to tell Gary I was in here singing to him. Here at LaRose's, getting a little order for Eric to take back to Louisville, Kentucky, so he has some famous LaRose pizza. And for Miss June. Well, got the order in. Thought I'd just walk down here and get you a little long shot of that horse thing out there by the flag. Isn't that nice they put that up there? That is really great. Right here at the Rose's Carryout and the Dunkin' Donuts. They're going to bring it out to the car, so I'm going to go ahead and hop in here. Behave myself, which is a challenge. Let's see now if I can turn this around, get this set up again. Good Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. I think that's good right there.
Hey, Gare. How you doing, John right. Stevenson?
You working hard?
Oh, no, we're not. No, no touching.
You doing all right?
Yeah, doing okay.
Good.
They just ordered pizza and had to take back to the house, and they're going to bring it out when they get it ready. Are you doing okay?
Yeah.
The missus?
Yep. You still down on Bristol or down on
McCullum Pike? Yep, still there. Still hanging in there.
Still around.
Still politicking as best I can. Nice to see you. Gary Halberstadt. Over on Wolf Road, where I grew up as a little boy. You've seen some of them little boy pictures with my dogs. Collie. My favorite. And we had Pluto out on Martin and Moffat Roads, which is a hunting dog. Boy, he was good. Gary Halberstadt lived right across the street from us there on Wolf Road. His father's name was Gilbert Halberstadt and worked many, many years at the telephone company where I worked for a short period of time while I was working my way through school, Cincinnati Bell. Great company and great people. My cousin worked there many years, Pete Bingham. In fact, several family members and friends, Richard Peebles, who graduated from Simon Kenton High School, worked there for many years, retired. Bobby Exler worked there, I believe, and I think Bill Exler did too. Both probably retired from Cincinnati Bell. All lived on Wolf Road there. Dudley Martin, Ricky Williams, the Williamses. I'll tell you what, times go by. Times go by. Listening to WIOK 107.5 FM on the radio dial. I got my mask on now, but I don't think we have to have it on in the car like this. A little hard to breathe with it on, to tell you the truth. I'm going to lower it down just a little bit unless somebody else comes to the car. Then I'll put it back up. Wish I had my songs with me. I'd sing you a song. Well, it's a Sunday anyway, isn't it? Yeah, I might be able to sing a little song myself. Let's see here. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today, than to be the king of a vast domain. Now here comes Gary out. Let's see. Hey, Gare.
Yeah.
Give me a little conversation about what you remember over on Wolf Road. My camera can pick it up right in here.
Oh man. Now what you, I remember.
You live. We were neighbors there. I right across the street from. Your dad's name was Gilbert.
Yep.
And your mom's name was
Betty.
Betty.
Yeah.
And they lived there for many years, didn't they?
Yeah. Yeah, and then they moved from there up on Old Tanner Mill just before the two of them come together up there.
Now, how old are you?
75.
You're 75 now?
Well, next month I'll be 76.
I'm 76 right now.
Yeah.
And so you were just a little bit younger than me there.
About a year, yeah.
And but we played together and had a lot of good times, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
And do you remember the Williamses?
Yeah.
Hope Williams.
Hope,
and
yeah.
And the Culbersons.
Yeah. And then Martins.
Ruth and Henry Culberson. Yeah. Now what was the Martins? That was Dudley Martin.
Dudley Martin, yeah.
And Dudley Martin and what was his?
Bishops lived right next to them.
Now was that Barbara Bishop? from Simon Kenton, yeah. I remember her, and Barbara Bishop, and then now Rita Williams lived down a little lower down there, didn't she? Yeah. And Ricky Williams.
Rick, yeah.
And Bobby and Bill Exler.
Yeah, they lived across from Williams.
Now, did you work at the phone company too, or?
No.
But now your dad did, didn't he, for years and years?
Yeah.
I thought so, because I worked at the phone company a short period of time.
He worked at the phone company, and then he ended up, when he retired, he was running the Williamstown garage.
Is that right?
Yeah, phone company, yeah.
Boy, oh boy.
Yep.
And what kind of work did you go into?
I delivered and drove for Airborne Express.
Or Airborne Express.
Air Freight Company.
My, oh my.
Yeah.
And you graduated from Simon Kenton what year?
62.
62, you was 1 year behind me, then I was 61. And Jimmy Noakes was, I think, 62 or 63.
He was 63.
And then Eddie Smallwood was 63, I think. Now, I still see them quite regularly.
Yeah.
Eddie Smallwood was living down in Florida, still is down in Florida, but he comes up, and his mom still lives over here on 3L right across from the city building. She's 95.
Okay.
And has read her Bible through 55 years, straight years, every year. Can you believe that? Alita Smallwood's her name. Now, she lived right down the road from us, her and Eddie and Jimmy did, when I moved out to Martin Road and Moffett Roads. And that's where we knew them from.
Yeah.
And but I loved the place back there. It still stands. That house is still on Wolf Road.
Yeah.
Across the street there. I don't know who lives there now. I did stop and say hi to him one time.
No, I don't know who lives there. Alfred's lived.
Who lived next door to us on Wolf Road? Do you know who, other than Williams's?
Down in the dip?
No, before
Alfred,
you...
Alfred, you lived in the White House.
I lived in the White House.
And there was a big dip in there, and Alfred's lived in that next house.
That next house.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then Williams's and Culberson's were right next to us before you went down the dip.
Yeah. Well, no. I'm coming from the Taylor Mill.
From Taylor Mill, we were the first house. We were about the sixth house.
Right. Well,
and then the Williams's.
Across from our house.
Oh, across from your house was?
Was a dip down in the, off the road.
Oh, really?
And then your White House set right next to that.
Right next to that.
And then the Williams and Culbertson's.
Yeah.
And then you drop down over the hill.
Yeah, Hope Williams. Yeah, and then you drop down over the hill. And then the Exlers lived down here on the left.
Yeah.
Bill and
Carl Ward. Carl Ward lived. Ward lived the first, second houses after he went over the hill.
Carl and Gary Ward.
Yeah. And then, what was the girl's name? Sarah lived next to Ward back there.
Now, do you remember the Luzaders?
Yeah. They lived up in the first.
They lived in the house right across the street from Wolf Road, I think.
Yeah.
Diane.
On the same side.
On the same side, was it? The Luzaders.
Yeah.
And, now, she's married to a professor now. I went to their house about a year there, went to their house for a home Bible prayer meetings class.
Across from Luzaders there, across the highway,
Donna Luzader?
No, Diane Miller.
Diane Miller, huh?
Miller's lived there.
And let's see, now Dieter's lived right up around the ways there a little bit.
They lived up towards town further, by St. Matthew Circle.
Yeah.
On the corner.
Boy, oh boy, time's passed. You know, you remember all that stuff. And I drive by down there once in a while and take a little video of it and talk about it a little bit down there.
Baker's lived in the farmhouse there. Ronnie Baker.
Ronnie Baker. And then do you remember the Waymans that had who had the milk? We got our milk from some farm up on Taylor Mill there.
Yeah, it was up the road farther, up towards the Skyway.
Now, did you have any older brothers or sisters?
I had a sister who was younger.
It was younger, that's what I thought.
Linda.
How's she doing?
She passed away years ago.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
You know that? You don't know what's going to get you. I've been trying to keep this virus from getting me.
Yeah, you and me both.
Well, you take care.
All right, you take
love
care.
You. Tell everybody said hello. Gary Halberstadt. Now, how neat that was. Hope that got on the video there.
sometimes you don't know just how, and when you're shooting some video, when an opportunity is going to show up to find somebody that that you meet that you haven't seen in for a long time, and that you can get some history from. You know, history is the light to our future. I always say that as a history teacher. I had Dr. Charles Talbert for 4 years at Northern Kentucky, well, Northern Kentucky University branch of UK. Now it's Northern Kentucky University. I was president of student body there in 1968 when they got the four-year college started. And of course, Miss June graduated from Northern after it became Northern in 1978, I think is what she told me. But I just think it's just absolutely wonderful when you run into somebody like Gary there and you can talk a little bit about old times and the history. And history is the light to our future. It's a pathway to our past and our future. And we can learn from our history. If we haven't learned from history, we haven't learned anything. And that's one thing we got to keep our mind on with this coronavirus thing, is history. Document all of this. What's done, what's not done, what you needed to do, what you didn't need to do. And our elected officials would be very wise if they practiced the art of cajoling people to do what needs to be done without trying to do it with orders. Because when you're starting to start violating people's constitutional rights and liberties, you're going to turn some people against you. Just like the governor here in Kentucky made one terrible mistake. He did everything else pretty daggone well, I'd have to say, except leaving the abortion clinics open. And that's where he got himself tied in with. They were big contributors to him. And that, like most politicians, unfortunately, once they get into office and they've had to raise all that money to get into office, then they wind up having to be subservient to those people who put the money in. As old Bert Combs, former governor, taught me, John, when I rode around with him as a young man campaigning for him, said, John, the difference between a good governor, a bad governor, the good governor controls the fat cats, the bad governor is controlled by the fat cats. And that's unfortunately what happened to young Andy Beshear, the money givers of the Planned Parenthood and the abortion clinics down there. Goodness gracious sakes alive, how do you justify you saved 250 people's lives? All the work we all did, which is wonderful and a great thing to do, but leaving those abortion clinics open for the same time period when everything else is shut down, leaving them open, murdered 1,000 babies. 1,000 babies, saved 250 lives, and half of those were seniors who in the later years had extenuating circumstances. But it's great to save those lives, but it's terrible to let those little innocent babies be killed, be murdered. Now, something I'm going to say something here that that we need to do, all of us, all the Christians, all the people, all the citizens. Now, we've got a nation right now. It's actually got hundreds and hundreds and thousands, millions of people who have been a part of these abortions. And it's a sin. There's no doubt about that. Anybody that reads the scriptures can tell that. It's a sin and an affront to God. But we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So if you've out there been a part of an abortion or had an abortion yourself, take the guilt off of yourself and go to God and ask Him for forgiveness. But then turn around and try to do something to encourage people not to do the same thing, not to commit the same sin. Now, that's the key to the thing. I've sinned a lot myself. And I've asked God to forgive me of my sins, but then I go out and try to ask people not to. Well, here's the folks from La Rosa's. Now, ladies, hand me one in here at a time.
All right,
there you go. You got it? Now, folks, this is service at the curb, and I'm gonna ask you, if I open the back door here, can you put these in the back for me?
Yeah, of course.
If you can put them in the back there. And then
I want to give you that, and you take that and share that tip with whoever you want to share it with.
Thank
in there.
Thank you.
That's a little tip for being so nice to the old country boy here, Farmer Superintendent of Education, Commonwealth of Kentucky.
Thank you.
God bless you, and have a good day.
You too.
Now, that was nice. And we did something constructive there. But coming back to that, as we're driving home here, I want to ask you to, as I said, if you've been a part of that and that's happened to you, there's a lot of things we can do as young people. There's a lot of things that we shouldn't do as young people. And when you sin and make a mistake, you just have to sort of grapple with it. We all fall into those shortcomings, and we should not, I'm not saying that you need to be punished by people. I'm saying the secret to it is you don't want to be punished by God, and because that's an affront. It isn't a choice. The choice was made by somebody else who got someone pregnant, some man or some rapist or some incest or somebody else, and that's their sin, and they need to ask for forgiveness, and we need to protect people and honor the ladies of the country and the world, the ladies to be honored. Now, here's what I hope that you can do. Ask God to forgive you, and then go out and help us to get other people not to commit the sin of abortion, not to take a life. And if you're a man out there, stand up for your responsibility and support these children, and don't try to get out of your problem by paying for an abortion or trying to convince somebody they should go abort a child. That's the wrong thing to do. And if you've done that, ask God to forgive you and try to encourage others not to do that. Be a part of the protectors of the unborn and the born, and love. That's very important, love. The greatest gift God gave us is the gift of love. Now, I'm flying around here a little bit here, so my camera's bouncing around, so you're going to have a little bouncy uppy-downy here. But I thought to myself, how do I get across to that young governor that he's allowed himself into the same trap that Burton Combs told me about? Same thing with Congressman Breckinridge years ago, when I went to Washington with him. And he told me, he said, John, he said, you come up here with me. He said, help me set up my office. And he said, but when you come up here, I know you don't want to stay because you want to stay back and work with the people in Kentucky, which he was right. And he said, but when you come up here, don't get Potomac fever. And I asked him, I said, Congressman, that's John Breckinridge, United States Congressman, 6th Congressional District at that time. He said, don't get Potomac fever. I said, sir, what's Potomac fever? He said, well, that's when you get up here. They'll be wanting to take you around in limousines. They want to give you tickets to ball games. They want to take you out and wine and dine you and get you all liquored up and make great friends with you. And then they want you to do things for them. He said, just remember this. I want you to help everybody, all citizens, regardless of their party, regardless of their church, regardless of their age, regardless of their financial condition, help all citizens legally. And he said, if I find your hand in the cookie jar, I'm going to lop your fingers off one at a time. And I've never forgot that, and I still got all my fingers, thank goodness. But anyway, well, we're taking home a nice order of La Rosa's pizza here. I can smell it. My goodness gracious sakes alive. I will say this. I was having a little trouble because, you know, when you get a little older, you're on these water pills. And sheesh, I'm thinking, if they don't come out soon here, I'm going to be in trouble because I'm going to have to find the restroom. That's one of the dangers of having to go out on any distance today. Where do you stop to go to the restroom? Well, coming into Independence, they got the speed limit here, 25 miles an hour. And that's what I'm doing. Unfortunately, we're having to fight to get them to lower the speed over on McCollum Pike. There's McCollum Pike, and then there's McCollum Road. McCollum Pike's
the city part of it there, where you're, where you got all these kids living there along the street, including Miss June and I. And I called the transportation cabinet the other day, and I'm going to talk to them about lowering the speed over there to 25 miles an hour, because there's kids and seniors there that are going to get hurt. June's been about hit twice, and sheesh, I can't afford to lose her. So she told me, she said, John, you're always helping people all the time, all day long. You're on the phone helping people. Well, this is your wife. I need help. I've been about killed out there twice. Start calling some people and get something done about this. I said, yes, ma'am. So I've got a challenge there. So if you got any influence with anybody, call them and tell them to lower the speed limit on McCollum Pike, just from the courthouse and U.S. Bank down to the main new highway. That all should be 25 miles an hour. Here it says 35. That's too fast for here. You can see the mailboxes down here, and they come out of here, and they want to just shoot off and do 40 or 50 or 60 miles an hour down through here. It's dangerous, very dangerous. It's ridiculous. But we'll put that in God's hands, but I'll do my phone call and see what can be done. They're going to pull in here now to the little cottages that Gil and Jan Hammond own, and that we live here. There's Joel and Robin. Joel's got his new speaker we gave him. Praise the Lord, I tell you. Got the yard here clipped down a little bit. And so we're all ready to have a great day with Eric Diamond, our nephew up from Louisville, Kentucky, over to visit his mom and dad. And he is a mighty fine young man. A graduate with urban architecture degree from Western Kentucky University. So I'm looking forward to Hi, Eric.
Hi there.
Come on in.
Can I help you out of here?
Yeah, let me open a door here, a back door. And there's two bags there.
Okay.
Let me see here, Eric. Hang on just a second.
Yeah, can I help you with anything else?
No, I don't think so, but say hi to everybody.
Hi.
Great to be here with you, and nice to have Eric over visiting us today. He's got the La Rosas there and some La Rosas to take back to the Jordan, too.
Back in Louisville.
Back in Louisville. I'll be right in.
All righty.
Take care. We love you.
I love you, too.
He's a mighty fine young man. How you like that speaker?
I like it.
Do you?
Yeah, it worked out good.
Fantastic. Thank you. I love those things too. You can just sit there and turn them suckers up, and boy, I tell you, feel like you're in an orchestra.
Yep.
See you a little later. That's our nephew that's in from Louisville.
Oh, okay.
Eric. Well, we're in a little cottage here now. Oh, the first desk in the first home built in Fort Thomas, right there. Taliaferro House. Got that for Miss June because she's from Fort Thomas. As a little historical gift. And the patriotic bedroom. Miss June. Is tidy and neat, and that's hard to be with me around.
What's that? He's gonna rush, put that to the car, and then he'll be right back.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. I appreciate that. That's very nice of you to do.
Are we gonna go out to the front porch?
Yeah. I'm trying to circulate that.
Now I got my camera on, so don't be upset.
I'm staying behind it. That's why I'm where I am. Whoa.
Oh. Now
I want you to look at that bumblebee. There's about 25 of those around here talking to me.
I Windexed their front door, and it was really mean. I Windexed one of them.
Did you?
And I felt really bad after I did. But it scared them off. Might have killed them. They die really quick. Because I'll come out here tomorrow, and there'll be five or six of them dead.
All right, Miss Junior.
Don't film this.
Don't film it.
We're hugging.
Not going online.
Oh,
we're not allowed to put this online.
Yeah, we'll get it. We'll get Governor Beshear arresting it.
Now, there is a. What was I going to say?
I have no idea.
Well, we've had a nice visit by Eric. You're not. You're not supposed to touch each other.
He's my nephew. I never get to see him.
Well, that's true.
Well, at least the face mask on.
The face mask is on. We met until I get mine
on.
Get yours on, June. She's funny, isn't she, Eric?
She is.
She keeps being
just
stiff.
Put your, there you go. Just put your.
The other ones are blue, but those will be a pair of fun ones.
Thank you.
Now, we want everybody to know that I'm also got my mask on.
I use the turtleneck, my turtleneck when I'm
wearing it. Eric
has
got his mask on.
And I'm keeping 3.5 feet away.
And she's keeping 3.5 feet away. He's got his gloves on.
And we're staying social distancing with not posting on Facebook.
And we're staying social distancing and we're posting on Facebook.
We're not posting on Facebook.
And
I have no control over him.
And have a great day. And Eric, well, what's the company you're working for now?
JRA.
JRA. Architects. And that's a great company, and they're doing a great job, and Eric's doing a great job for them. Be sure and tell Jordan we said hello. What's the name of his company?
Jeff the Creed.
Who?
Jeff the Creed.
What's he say? With the mask on, it's hard to get
spell
that.
It.
Jeff the Creed.
Spell it.
It's, I think it's J-E-D-T-H-A. I don't know.
Jeb, J-E-B.
Yeah. Please don't post this on Facebook.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, John. Please.
And
I'm not sure how to spell it.
But it's a good job.